Good morning and welcome to Raffles Open Week. For today's session, we're going to do a career talk from psychology department. Okay. In order to do that, I would like to introduce one of our lecturers from psychology department, Ms. Eamon.
Hi.
Good morning. Morning. How are you today?
I'm good. How about you?
I am super, super good. Okay, I think we can start our career talk, okay, which I think you can introduce yourself first to our audience.
Okay, thanks, Khairul. So, good morning, everyone. I'm lecturer at Raffles KL, teaching in psychology. Okay, so at Raffles College of Higher Education, we do have diploma in applied psychology, okay? Today I will be more like MC or host. Okay, so we will have a main speaker, okay, Dr. Samuel from Raffles University, to share with us on career and pathway in psychology. So, morning, Dr. Samuel.
Good morning. Good morning.
Yeah.
Hi, good morning, everybody. Yes, go ahead, Eamon.
Yeah. You can have the stage.
Oh, okay. Thank you. So I'm taking over the stage now. All right. Thank you. Yes. Good morning, everybody. And this is my great pleasure to be here with you all. And I believe when we're talking about psychology, a lot of people were confused about that and say, hey, what does it mean by psychology? And what do we need to be in psychology? And what can psychology help us, you know, other than reading somebody's mind? Because, you know, reading somebody's mind is not psychology, actually. Reading somebody's mind is a psychic. So if you would like to read somebody's mind, please, you're not necessary to come to psychology. You may easily to go to any of the street, you know, learn from some psychic reader out there. And you don't need to be that professional with so many theory and suffering 3 years in the school. But then when we're talking about psychology, what else that we can have in psychology? Can we have somebody share the screen with me? Share the screen for me, please. Thank you. Share to my PowerPoint screen. All right, there you go. Okay, now when we talk about psychology, what can we do about that? Yeah, and this is very important. Now, first of all, when we talk about psychology, we need to know that psychology is not only psycho. Psychology involved with many places, yeah? So one of the thing is we need to take a look of what is psychology. Now, before we go into the concept about what is psychology, let's think about this. Can you name any industry or career in this world that does not need psychology? If I'm giving you 5 seconds to think about that, most likely you say, oh yeah, there's a lot, you know, well, music, no need psychology, or arts, no need psychology, fashion design, no need psychology. Let me tell you, everything we need psychology. For example, we still talk about music. No, music is if something that connect with your cognitive behavior. And when we talk about fashion, fashion is something about the human behavior together with cognitive, and also even if business. Business, we talk about the organizational psychology, behavior and influence in organization, all of it is psychology. Now, some people might make fun to have that and say, hey, what about if I am having a casket business, a funeral business? You do need more psychology than anybody else, in fact, in that particular industry. Why? Because, you know, when you are going to that particular industry, you need psychology in counseling. You need to know, you need to understand some kind of psychology, like psychology of aging and something like that. Education, we do have educational psychology. And everything, we have that. Meaning to say that it's not possible to have any industry in this world that don't need psychology. Yeah. So that is something to give us a clue, saying that because the goal of the psychology is to describe the behavior. Now, once we talk about describe the behavior, that means that when we describe, we not only describe it, but then we also go to explain the behavior, we go to predict. We explain, the reason for us to explain is because we do need to predict. Why we need to predict? Because we would like to know whether they have any change in the behavior, or what can we do if there is some unwanted behavior that coming into our life, how can we change it? How can we alter it? or how can we have something, you know, in between so that we are able to help us, you know, to get ourselves, improve our life and all these other things. So that is the goal of the psychology. So when we talk about that, now we may also would like to know about the family of psychology, because the family of psychology can be very big. It's bigger than any of the family that you can even thought of. Yeah. So what is the what kind of family that we have? What kind of family members that we have in the psychology? First of all, in the family of psychology, we do have some members from the most scientific over to the most humanistic. You say, wow, that's a lot. Yes, that's a lot. They do have a lot. Now, talking about that kind of family members, now in Raffles University, actually we are emphasis in the psychology, in the science. So when we talk about that, after you graduate, you are having the bachelor degree in science, in psychology. So what is that in science? What kind of science that we are talking about? Now, we do have the science in cognitive, in neuro, in statistic, and in abnormal. Those are very scientific module that you have in psychology. Now, if we talk about the humanistic, now we have some module are very humanistic, like cross-cultural study. Yeah, we have the cross-cultural psychology. Those are very humanistic. And then we have the social psychology, also very humanistic. And then we do have something that in between, something like, you know, organizational psychology, behavior and inference in organization, and also some other module, something like, you know, like family dynamic, counseling. Those are the module that is staying between scientific and humanistic module. And also we have some developmental psychology like child and infant, adolescent and adulthood. Yeah, emotion and motivation. Those are the module that stay in between. So can you see that? This is very interesting. Psychology can be very interesting and they cover everything and anything. So when we talk about that, when you come to the psychology, when you are in the psychology major, so what are you going to study? Well, of course, one thing we keep our promise. We will promise that when you're coming in, we will keep you very busy. You can be very, very busy. Why? Let's take a look at this. Because in psychology, you need to go to this five palette. Okay. One of it is the biological palette that you have, like when we talk about the neuroscience, sensation, that is something unconscious. Those are like behavioral, because psychology of learning. And then we have the sensation, like psychology of cognitive psychology. And then we have the neuroscience. And then the neuroscience is like we have the neuro, we have just called neuropsychology. Yeah. And then we also have the cognitive psychology. And then we also have some thinking, intelligent memory. Yeah. All these kind of things that will have related to us, related to our life. Now, for that, let me explain a little bit about each of the major, some of the core or major psychology module that you may like to learn in psychology major, so that you will be able to get some idea about what's going on and what that thing is happened to be. Now, let's take one example from the scientific way, the one that have like the most scientific in psychology, we call neuropsychology. This is very, very scientific one. Therefore, you know, if you are not in the science major or the science stream, then that is a challenge for you. Now, the neuropsychology, what are we going to learn? We go to learn how brain work. So that means I always make fun to many people. I told them, I know a lot of lecturers from other faculty hate me a lot, because I told them, psychology, the faculty of psychology, or we call social science, is the only faculty in the whole university that have brain. Do you know that? Yes, we have brain. Yeah. Why we have brain? Because we study brain. That's why we have brain. Yeah. So we like to learn how the brain work and all this. Now, so the study, the relationship between behavior, emotion, and also the cognitive on one hand, and then the brain function on the other hand. This is the way that we study the normal function of a brain and then how this brain related. So in the future, when we study other module, then we are able to relate it. We are able to utilize this knowledge in neuroscience over to the other module so that we can get better understanding about some others. So, of course, when we talk about the brain working, and then we need to know how that thing is function and so on and so forth. But then we also have some psychology that's strongly related to the brain due to neuroscience is the cognitive psychology. What is the cognitive psychology is about? Cognitive psychology is a study of how people perceive, learn, remember, and think about the information. Now, when we talk about that, we know that they have something called perception. Perception is something we receive the signal and then how we translate the signal. For example, right now when I'm talking, maybe some of you, you know, will perceive in some part of the word that I'm having, and some of you might, you know, only take a look of the screen and they say, oh, okay, there's somebody, you know, showing on the screen and you know, having some activities there and so on and so forth. And then some, and then also in cognitive psychology, we also talk about the attention, we talk about memory and all. Now, when we talk about the attention, think about that. What is this vase going to give you the information? Some people say, they that look like two faces here. Yeah, because of your perception. Because of your perception, you thought about, you know, this is like a two faces. But some other people, they may not think about that. They may say, hey, no, this is just an object that stay in the middle of the picture. So can you see that? No. And also, we are having some cognitive psychology that dealing with the memory. When we talk about memory, I believe, if I'm asking you this question, do you remember what is 1 plus 1? Oh, say, hey, that's easy. 1 plus 1 equals 2. Yeah, I know. Why you know that? Because you learned it when you were in your kindergarten. Wow, that's way before we met, right? Way before we met, way before you are in this session at this moment. Now, so you are having, I will pretend you are having a very good memory. So tell me what you ate this morning. You say, oh, okay, I have bread, I have toast, I have eggs, I have coffee, I have tea, whatever it is. Good, wonderful. Now, tell me what you ate on March 28, 2020. I guess suddenly everybody's silent because you really don't care. What you ate? Huh? I know I ate something, but what I ate, I didn't remember. Now, let's make something closer. Well, if you say you are driving to some place this morning, maybe Cairo, can I have you on the screen for a minute and let me check with you with something? Yeah, show your face here. Okay. Yep. Okay, Cairo, let me ask you one question. Yeah. Are you driving to the campus this morning? Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay. Now, what car you are driving?
Produa Beza.
Okay, wonderful. See, you remember that. Now, let's try another question. Now, on the first traffic light, when you stop, okay, on the first traffic light that you use when you stop, what is the car that on your right-hand side?
Wow, it's tricky.
Can you see that? Can you see that? That is cognitive psychology. Now, thank you. Thanks for Cairo to join me with this fun little experiment. Can you see that? This is called memory, yeah? This is called memory because it's the information is not necessary. Therefore, we throw that away. Who care about the person next to me? Who care about the car next to me? On my right-hand side, am I having some car on my right-hand side? I didn't even recall, you know, sometimes. Maybe Cairo will say that. I didn't even recall. See, this is what we call the cognitive psychology. How fun to have that. Now, let's come to this. And then we see that other than the cognitive psychology, we do have the developmental psychology. Now, I need Cairo to bring my slide back to the screen. Yes, thank you. Yeah, development psychology. Now, let's let's zoom in this picture for a while for the developmental psychology. See what we learn from this. Now, here. In the developmental psychology, we learn how to learn. You say, What do you mean by I learned how to learn? Yes, that is a very fundamental question in many psychology. First of all, do you learn how to eat? No, you don't need it. Yeah, you don't need to learn how to eat. When you were born, you're so easy to get on. You're so easy to, you know, to suck the milk. Yeah, when your parents give it to you, that's easy. Immediately you get it. So you don't need to learn how to eat, but you learn how to enjoy food. For example, when can we put Iman back to the screen? Can we put Iman or Sean? Okay, Iman, what is your best food that you like the most? What is the food that you like the most?
Me?
Yes, of course. I'm not asking people behind you.
Cake.
Huh? Egg?
Cake.
Oh, heck. Why? Why you like it?
Because it's sweet, nice, delicious.
Wow, that's lovely. Now, since when that you learn how to enjoy cakes?
I don't know then.
Is it? Can you see that? That's very interesting, right? Yeah, why? Because this is called developmental psychology. We learn how to learn. We learn how to enjoy. We learn how to appreciate. You see that? This is a developmental psychology going to teach us. Yeah, we learn how to learn. So what is that thing is going to have? Now, I need Kairos to bring me back the PowerPoint. Yes, thank you. Now, what is this? Is like how we learn, and there is a process of information and learn. How we develop, you know, we process the information and we learn. Now, let's take Iman answer just now as an example. She responds, she loves cakes. But then since when? She doesn't know that. She has no idea. Because maybe some timeline in her life that, you know, hit her brain. See that now? We related to the neuropsychology. They hit her brain and then, boom, that information coming in. And after that, she said, wow, I enjoyed it. And she began to develop it, to develop that kind of fun and to develop that kind of, you know, sense, you know, so that, you know, she liked it.
Yeah.
So now, other than the developmental psychology, what else do we have other than process the information? Now, in the developmental psychology, it is a science approach that aims to explain growth, change, and consistency through the lifespan. When we were young, we may love something, but then when we're getting older, we may love the other thing. Now, actually, we love something is more than food. We may love color. They may have some color that we appreciate. We may love some kind of costume, because they may have some outfit that we really appreciate. They may love to see certain kind of people, because those are the people we get more familiar with. Or we may have something else in our life that, you know, we really would like to know what's going on. And then maybe throughout our lives, there's sometimes they may have something that we get, we hate it, or you know, or maybe we don't like it, or something like that. So developmental psychology gives us a lot of information. Now, let's go to that. And then social psychology. What is social psychology? Social psychology is a discipline to use scientific method to understand and explain how the individual are influenced by the presence of others. Your parents influence how you grow. You influence your friends with how they communicate with you. Wow, this is a social psychology. This is something that we have in our life. Now, in the social psychology, one of the typical examples is like some of our students, if you come to Raffles, you know that some of our students would like to do some awareness program. Now, they are doing the awareness program to others' university, to others' high school. Now, this is part of their program that they did. Now, maybe one of the social psychology topic is self-image. They are the one that learn about self-image, how you see yourself. Now, they also have some people that learn about the school bullying. Why you bully somebody and why somebody got bullied. Or maybe you're not bully somebody, or but then you not get bullied, but then you saw, you witnessed that, and then you feel very upset. You say, why they have things happen like this? Or sometimes they may have something else, like, you know, like peer pressure. They also have a lot of the peer pressure activities that happen, like, you know, when you were in your high school, you always have peer a word, hey, go la, don't go la, you know, eat la, don't eat la, you know, all this kind of thing. Sound very familiar? Yes, of course, it's very familiar. You don't know why? Because it's a peer pressure. Yeah. And a lot of times your friends will persuade you to go certain places, or, you know, to push you to certain places, or something like that. Okay. So how? Sometimes some peer pressure is good. Sometimes some peer pressure is no good. So that is something that we learn. If there's some kind of a very small part of the topic that we involve in the social psychology. Now, other than the social psychology, what else do we have? Well, we have something else very interesting. We have the cross-cultural psychology. You never know that. Now, cross-cultural psychology is one of the very important topics nowadays, because we are talking about globalization. When we talk about the globalization, cross-cultural psychology is giving a lot of impact over to that. Many multinational corporation, you know, they are using cross-cultural psychology because they would like their employee all over the world to have a happy working environment. Therefore, a cross-cultural psychology is something that's coming in. Now, what is a cross-cultural psychology? It's a psychology with a cultural perspective. A psychology with a cultural perspective, who you are, why you are here, and when you think about this, does that mean that other people also think about that? Now, some of the concept that, you know, coming very obvious is individualist and collectivist. Yeah, Asian usually been labeled as a collectivist, and, you know, a lot of the Westerner always been labeled as a individualist. But then, other than that, do we have anything else to talk about? Oh, yes, you know, let me show you the other one. That is the understanding about the culture, about the food, about the color, about the belief, you know, what kind of religion that they have, you know, certain religion, they're giving different kind of impact, you know, like, for example, we talk about marriage. Different group of people having different style in marriage. Now, how is that marriage is about? Indian have their own marriage style, as Malay, as Chinese, you know, they all have difference. Now, marriage is one part of it. Now, how to treat newborn is another one. And wow, they also have people to treat funeral. Funeral is another one. Now, they have so many types of funeral in the world, that how people are going to talk about that. And what about the food? What about the behavior? Now, certain kind of behavior was welcoming by certain group, but not welcoming by others group. And then also the color. Now, certain color was welcomed by certain group of people, but not welcomed by other group of people as well. So can you see that? There's understanding of what is a culture with different type of style and different type of the thing that we have. Even the language itself can give a lot of different impact. Now, probably we speak English, but then other people also speak English as well. But not everybody express the same meaning when we are expressing English in front of other people. Yeah. So can you see that? There is a lot and lot of the difference in between the culture. Every culture is unique. And then how we go to put all this uniqueness together so that we are able to know what is going on. Now, how does cultural influence? Now, the cultural influence a lot, like the human behavior and the mental process. Because of that, therefore, they have a set of the culture that influence how they behave and what they want and how they need it. So therefore, they are always something unique. They are always something interesting for people to see it, for people to enjoy it. Now, of course, in our school again, we do... before the MCO, I'm talking about before the MCO, I always like to bring students over to other country or other places. Yeah, it all depends on that, on the particular semester for sure. And to let them, you know, enjoy and have a feeling about the atmosphere of others' places and others' culture. Now, actually, back to 2017, we have the first trip to Hong Kong. And then on 2018, we have a trip to Japan. And in 2019, we have a trip to Macau. And we bring students over to Macau. Then, you know, we are showing them the house of life in Macau. And then even though there are Chinese over in Macau, and then we have Chinese in Malaysia. But what kind of life difference is that? You know, in Macau, they have people speak Portuguese. And how was that life? It was different. Now, let me show you a small little video to let you enjoy what is that is about before we continue. Yeah.
Is what you came for. Lightning strikes every time she moves, and everybody's watching her, but she's looking at you.
They always have a lot of fun. Yep. And then they always have a lot of fun to have that. Yeah. All right. Now, after that, we also have something very in the very business area. We talked about the organizational psychology. Well, what is organizational psychology? It's a scientific study and apply the psychology principle to organization and the workplace, like how you go to recruit people, how to find the right work-life balance, and so on and so forth. We have all these that coming into it, and they also have the organization psychology to tell how we can we pick the people, pick the right people to the right job, how we go to build a better working environment. All of this is all in our organizational psychology. Now, by the way, the picture that you saw here, those are the time when we are combining the concept of organizational psychology with the trip that we visit in Japan, in Nagoya. That time we visit Nagoya, we go direct to the Toyota company, we go to the production line there, and then we also visit the production line in Toyota, and also we have the collaboration with NITEC, Nagoya Institute of Technology, to do some kind of like a VR and also the kind of VR and work life safety, the OSHA. So those are the things that we have been doing. Yeah. So this is the organizational psychology that we have. Now, other than this one, you also have some abnormal psychology. Now, when we talk about abnormal psychology, probably there are people to think about, they must have dealing with a bunch of crazy people. No, not yet. Because abnormal psychology is talking about abnormal, right? But how are we going to prevent, how are we going to educate the people to treat other people better? This is called the abnormal psychology. So for this, we need to know how we're going to deal with stress, panic, anxiety, you know, how we're going to detect it, disorder. Like sometimes, you know, some young ladies, probably they will like to look more skinny. Then how are they going to deal with the eating disorder? Yeah. And how the kind of bulimia is coming in, you know, for people to be aware of it, or how you're going to detect your friends is whether they are okay or not. How about the somatic complaint? Now, the somatic symptoms. And now today we have a lot of kids, they really hate to go back to the school. Then so they will always have some somatic complaint. So how we go to know that? So all of this is part of the abnormal psychology. It's part of the knowledge in abnormal psychology. Now, other than the abnormal psychology, so what else that we are having? So we are now coming back to ask one question. Hey, we are having so many modules here. We've been studying so many modules. What can we do? What can we do after that? Now, back to about 20, 30 years ago, when I'm studying psychology, probably they have a lot of people don't understand what it means by psychology. They always relate psychology to abnormal, which is wrong. Now, of course, after you study psychology, not means you are a psychiatrist. Psychiatrists need to have a medical base and then come to study psychology as a top-up, you know, knowledge. But then psychology is not. Psychology is having the psychology base, and then we are doing a lot of things called facilitator or counseling. Now, of course, you want to do the counseling, you do need to go a further study in your counseling. Then you are going to obtain a license before you can be a counselor. However, you can be a facilitator. You can work in the HR. You can work in many of the area that is related to the psychology. For example, we do have clinical psychologists. Yeah, that is the one that you work in the hospital. And then we are talking about the counselor and the counseling psychologist. You also have education. Well, I guess many of us maybe feel a bit upset about the educational system in a country. Now, not all countries, they were happy about their educational system. But then think about this. When you are having some kind of the module or some kind of the subject that's been designed, how are they going to design that? A lot of time they was depend on the advice from an educational psychologist. So those are the educational psychologists that were having it. Now, they also have some health psychology, also the occupational psychology. Now, and also some of the sport and exercise psychology. Like Lee Chong Wei last time when he was playing so good in his badminton, actually, there's a sport psychologist that's helping him. So that, you know, to advise him about what's going on and how the thing is going to be. So those are the ones that directly related to the degree that you have. Now, other than that, you know, psychology can also be strongly related to many other programs, like the AI program. I remember that one of our alumni now working in the AI program, no, two, actually it's two. One is working in a company that designed the AI program. Now, AI program, actually, they were strongly related with psychology. Probably you have no idea that is the way it is. Why? Because, think about this. When you are using AI machine to detect somebody, how do you know that their behavior is normal or abnormal? So when that behavior is normal or when their behavior is abnormal, how was that kind of labor that they want to send a signal over to certain people? Like, for example, when the labor is up to a yellow, up to orange or up to red, then in different labor, how they go to differentiate that and how they go to have it happen. So those are the AI. And we have actually one alumni is now currently studying her AI program. They call AI program psychologist. Yeah, in German. She got a full scholarship anyway. So she was working there. Now, they also have some people that find it very interesting to have the to be a detective, a forensic. Yeah, you have that in the forensic section in the police department. You think that that job very cool, but then if you're not happy to see a lot of dead body or blood or anything, you better don't go. Yeah. So those are the forensic, and then they also have some facilitator, educational consultant. Yeah, like many of those people in Raffles. Yeah, like in Raffles College, RKL, or in Raffles University, they all need certain kind of psychology knowledge in order for them to knowing the student well, and then to know what's going on. And also marketer, social worker, and so on and so forth. There's so many career that strongly related to psychology that we all need it. Yeah. So when we talk about that, now we can stop sharing that. Carol, back to, yes. Now, when we talk about that, all of this kind of program was strongly related to psychology. Now, there was not an excuse for you not to know psychology. Actually, statistically saying, in this world today, we have a lot of jobs maybe obsolete. But then, they also have some job that is not obsolete at all. One of the job is statistic, data analysis. That's hardly to be replaced by the machine. The second one, the other one is psychology, because psychology is the one that deals directly with human behavior. So when we talk about that, how can that be obsolete? That is the question. Therefore, can you see that? Now, if you have not decided what major that you are going to have, one thing that you can consider is coming to the psychology and then to well prepare yourself, because after that, well, we can have that thing, you know, happen to well prepare you, so that, you know, in the future, if you would like to persuade in any of the career, at least you have the base of psychology that will make you feel a little bit more easier and more comfortable when you deal with something else. Like, well, in a company as a HR, then you want to deal with the stressed employee. Or, you know, when you are in the education, when you want to deal with some school curriculum or some student behavior. Yeah. So all of this can be done. All right. So I guess I hope that, you know, in this short sharing, I can provide you some information about that. All right. Thank you. And back to you, Carlos and Edmund. Yeah. Yeah. Carlos and Edmund. Yeah. Back to you.
Listen. We might have students to come around, and in the meantime, Miss Imun can.
Emin, your voice was unmute yourself before asking your question.
Hello.
Yes, we hear you.
Okay. Okay, so those who just join us in the middle, thank you, Dr. Samuel from Raffles University to share with us on career and pathway in psychology. Okay, so is there any questions from the floor? Okay. While we are waiting, maybe I continue sharing using the I love cake example with you guys. Since Dr. Samuel bring about that just now. Okay. So let me see if that is possible to share the hold on now. Cairo.
Yes, I'm here.
Can you help me to share my slide?
Okay, you just share the screen there. I will feature it into the stream.
Just hold on.
Click share.
Share, only says share screen.
Okay, share.
Yes.
Share screen, click the share screen.
Okay.
That will be option for you.
My slide is in.
You need to open your slide first, then leave it there. Go to the share just now. Do the same thing. Then you can choose from the options.
Give me a second. Is it share now? Haru, is the slide sharing on screen now?
Yes, your slide is shared to the screen now. You can offer it. You can share it. You can start presenting. Okay.
So in Raffles College Kuala Lumpur, we do have diploma in applied psychology. Okay, so let's use the I love cake example to summarize after what have been shared by our Dr. Samuel this morning. Okay, so I love cake. Okay, maybe I enjoy cake with my friends. Okay. So from the introduction to psychology, we will look into why people love sweet things like cake. And then from the human growth and development, okay, maybe we look into why we have this kind of memory. Maybe every birthday celebrations, I do have cakes with my family and friends. So social psychology, I do enjoy eating with my loved one. So emotions and motivation, maybe we will look into, besides loving, enjoying the cake, I also love baking, okay? And history, and then we also have other subjects related to psychology. Or if you want to look into, what is the texture, what is the deco, of the cake, and then you want to sell cake, then you can learn how to form a team, okay, in starting a business, okay. So different subjects, you will able to learn a different thing, and that's a wonderful part of psychology, okay. And also neuropsychology, when after we eat, okay, we consume the cake, how would our brain, nerve, organs process that?
Iman, you're silent.
Hello?
Okay, good.
Okay, so that's what we learned from.
All right. Actually, we have one question directed to Dr. Sam. Okay. Here is the question.
Okay. What's your question?
There, in the display.
Okay. We can share now how is important psychology in this current pandemic, since a lot of mental health issues case arise. Yes. Coping with stress, coping with anxiety. Yeah. This is one of a very important thing that a psychologist can do in the current pandemic. Think about that. When a person is been locked in the environment without interact with people. Psychologist is here working on it to help to promote a kind of life, giving people a different point of view of doing it. Second, in the educational psychology, is coming in involving in redesign many of the curriculum. Because of that, redesign so that they will be able to suggest or help many of the educational institutions, so then they will be able, you know, to be better to catering many of those people who really see that, who really can cope with it. Like, for example, now we're talking about online learning. But what kind of learning is online learning? Are we only sharing the PowerPoint through online, meaning that it's called online learning? Or we do have some other method? Like, how was that method is going to combine with others' method, like the hybrid method or anything like that? Now, the other thing is that how the developmental psychologist coming involved is different period of time of the development of a human, how they learn, how they cope with it. For example, during the pandemic, we deal with the student in the kindergarten. We deal with the student in primary school. We deal with student in secondary school. We deal with student in university. Different period of time, they need, that their need is different. So how does that going to meet, how our design, how our curriculum structure going to meet their needs? All of this was strongly related by psychology. Can you see that? Yeah. I'm only giving a small example. Actually, they have more than that. And also, like, sometimes, like, organizational psychology, deal with work from home, how that work from home is going to cope, how the employer as a boss will be happy to see their work being carried onward, carried forward, how the employees as a worker, how they can cope with work from home and not get stressed and not get burned out. So all of this is related to psychology. Yeah. So back to you, Kairos. See any other questions that you are looking for?
We do have one more question. Okay. Here is the question.
Okay, one more question. Okay. Many people confused when it came to the role of psychologist, counselor, and psychiatrist. Maybe you can share a little bit of difference. Thank you. Okay. Now, talking about the role of psychologist, probably me and many of us, you know, after you graduate from the psychologist, you may identify yourself as a psychologist because you are professional training in psychology. Now, they have different types of psychologists, like the education psychologists, you call IO, industrial and organizational psychologists. They have the educational psychologists. They have the facilitator. They have so many things. They're all psychologists. Counselor is different. Counselor, that means that you have to go into the professional training in counseling. In Malaysia, especially in Malaysia perspective, you need to go to the counseling training. And then after you graduate from the university, maybe from the master or from PhD in counseling, then they have certain criteria that you need to fulfill. After all, you go and apply a counselor license. Like, I am also a counselor. I have my counselor license. So that is the way it is. And this is a counselor. Psychiatry is different, as I talked about that before. Psychiatry is the one that have a medical base. They are a medical doctor. So then they, on top of the medical knowledge, I mean, like, maybe they are the general practitioner. Then on top of it, they add psychologist knowledge, the abnormal psychologist and also neuropsychologist, these two very fundamental information, knowledge that they have, add on it, then they are able to come out with the license for psychiatry. Now, the one is the difference in between. Psychiatry is the one that can prescribe medicine, but then they are not doing counseling. They are the one that prescribe medicine, but they are not doing counseling. Counselor is the one that coming in the counseling, and then they are looking for the phenomenon, they are looking for the method, they are looking for the way of how to cope with it. That's a counselor. Now, psychologist is the one that doing the planning. Many of the planning was involved by psychologists. like the organizational psychologists, they're doing the planning in the organization. Family dynamic psychologists, they're talking about how to cope with a good family, how to be how to be a person happy with their life in the work-life balance and all this sort of thing. So those are the psychologists. Yeah, so they have different, they have two different labels. But then, because we are in Malaysia and the knowledge of psychology still are catching up, therefore, they have quite a number of the role being confused. Yeah. But then luckily, in Malaysia, we do have a very strict rule in counselor, in very strict rule in psychologist, in psychiatric. Therefore, these two has been stand very firm. Other than this one, then we have the psychologists that coming in. So now this is another piece of land that they have to really come into it, to really smooth it out, to really set up some kind of rule and regulation. Otherwise, everybody can be a psychologist, right? So, and that's not fair, and that's not right too. Now, psychic reader is not a psychologist, that's one thing. Yeah. If you talk about psychologists, maybe your mom or your father can say, I know how to teach you, I know how to, using a can chasing you, I'm also a psychologist. Of course not, yeah. So they have many different, okay? So I hope that can solve some of the clue about the difference between psychologist, counselor, and psychiatrist.
All right. Back to you. We have one more question. I think it would be the last one. Okay, this is the representation of our existing student. Okay, the question goes.
Okay, what kind of job opportunity for them? A diploma. Now, unfortunately to say, if you would like to really pursue in psychology, the higher the degree that you have, the better, and then the better opportunity that you are having. A diploma is really has nothing much. But then, what can a diploma having? Most likely is like if you are having a kindergarten, if you are having a tuition center, that helps a lot. That helps a lot. Now, that helps a lot in your diploma degree, diploma certificate, yeah? And also some of the independent, some of the school, like, you know, international school or private school, they do hire quite a lot of the diploma holder to be their teacher, to be their assistant, teaching assistant or something like that, because you are the one that really have a lot of knowledge about psychology. Of course, if you have a further study for the degree in psychology, now, do the student highly recommend to further study for degree in psychology? Yes. I always encourage my students, if they can get higher, can get the opportunity, go for it. Go for the higher education, yeah. Like after you've done your diploma, then go to your degree. After your degree, go to your master. After your master, go to your PhD. Why? Because this certificate will be, every one of the certificate can be expired easily in 3 to 5 years. Needless, it doesn't matter what kind of degree that you have. Maybe you have your diploma or your degree or your master or your PhD. It can be expired in a short period of time. Why? Because this is the society, they keep on rolling. They move too fast. I've seen quite a lot of the PhD after some time of, you know, of done with their PhD, and then they didn't continue. After all, a lot of the knowledge they cannot catch up again. Like for example, today when we're talking about the family structure, we have so many family structure counseling that they never heard about that in their time. So therefore, please, you know, when you are having that, go for that, pursue that, and then look for that. Yeah. So those are the things that I will strongly recommend. The higher, the better. Yeah. Okay? So I will strongly recommend you to have that. Yeah. Back to you, Carol. I hope that my answer going to satisfy your needs.
Okay. Actually, that was it. All the questions that we have for today's session. And thank you, Dr. Sam, and also Ms. Imun. It was indeed an insightful sharing about psychology as a course and also about the pathway that the students can think and pursue whichever direction in the psychology they want to do. All right, So with that, we have come to the end of our session today. So is there anything more that you want to emphasize, Ms. Simon, before we end our session today?
It's okay. Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
I think my internet connection got a bit poor today. Okay. So you have, yeah, you can do the summary, Kairu.
Okay. So that's all for today then. Thank you again, Dr. Sam, for the your time and wonderful sharing about everything. Okay, and sorry for the noise. And hopefully in the near future, we can do similar activities. And to the students out there and the viewers, if you have more questions about psychology and the pathway that you want to pursue, you can always go to our Facebook, Raffles KL, also go to Raffles University Facebook, and you can try to interact with us through that, okay? And then we can have appointment or any other means to have a further discussion with you. Okay, with that, I would like to say thank you and goodbye. And thank you, Dr. Sam. Goodbye, and Imon and Claire. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.